out a major problem happening, but I would be concerned about some portion of a major problem happening as well, but not all the way down.
All right, we got your table over here.
Okay.
It's got walnuts, cards, looks like butter and sponges. I have no idea what this is, but we're all gonna learn together. Ken Gerbino.
Okay, basically what you're gonna see here is a simple demonstration of economics. And you'll see how simple it is, and you're gonna understand inflation and why we have all the problems we're having today. Here we have a hammer. I tell you, we're gonna take it from the beginning of time. People used to make hammers, and people used to grow walnuts. And if a guy had a hammer and a guy had a bushel of walnuts, they would exchange, okay? He spent a certain amount of time making the walnuts or growing them. This guy spent a certain amount of time with the hammer. So they exchanged these things, and it was proper. They produced, they brought to the marketplace, and they exchanged. Okay, then what happened was gold came into play and paper came into play. But it was okay to have a piece of money if it was backed by a product. It was okay to have this piece of money backed by this hammer. It was okay to have this piece of gold, which was also sort of a product, backed by a piece of paper. So now we have, if you took this piece of paper, you could, people would believe in it. You could always get some walnuts for it. And same with the, because the guy with the walnuts could always come back and get a piece of gold. Everything is equal. There was something backing the money supply or the currency of countries. Now today, I'll show you what's happening today, and you'll see why all the economic theories that you've been hearing about and reading about by the powers that be aren't really true. Over here, we have the Federal Reserve System, which has gold and which has money. This much money, let's say. Here we have the government. The government needs money to do various things. And they say to the Federal Reserve, now I'm not against the Federal Reserve, they're doing a fairly decent job, but unfortunately what's evolved from the whole system here in this country and in other countries has gotten out of control. So we have the government here, and they say to the Federal Reserve, we would like to have some welfare to give to people, we would like to build certain things, we need money, we don't have it right now, we're the United States government. And what happens is, get my pen out here. They simply say to the Federal Reserve, I'd like to write you a note, an IOU, just like if you wrote a note to one of your friends, for $25 billion, let's say. So here's a piece of paper, $25 billion, and they send it over here to the reserve system. What that means now is that the reserve system now creates, allows the government to print $25 billion worth of paper, okay? Not backed by this, or by this, or by this. Not backed by a product, simply backed by a piece of paper, an IOU. The way the system is set up now, with $25 billion over here, this is an asset to the Federal Reserve. Someone owed you $25 billion, you would put that down as an asset of yours. You'd be very wealthy because you know you'd be getting paid for it. They have now a $25 billion asset, and what happens, the way the system is set up, it allows the financial institutions and the reserve system to lend out and issue an additional $125 billion into the economy. Now, there have been no more walnuts, and there have been no more hammers produced. All there is a simple piece of paper. So you see what's starting to happen. And you say to yourself, well, I can see there's a lot of money on the table and not very many products. How does this affect, you know, the economy? Well, you know, prices go up. Let's say this is the steel supplies. Here's this much money that the government takes and brings it over here to a foreign government. And they give it to them for free. This government, it's foreign aid, brings it back into the country. Okay, most of our foreign aid comes back anyway. We give them money and they buy our tractors, so. But still, notice the subtlety here. They take this foreign aid and come back into our economy, okay? And they consume production. They consume the steel. Now notice they did not come back and give us walnuts for that steel. They just gave us this paper. and they consume the steel. And then half the federal budget is involved in what they call transfer payments, which is welfare. And a lot of it is to the lower class people, but a lot of it's to the middle class people as well to administer it, where they're paying people not to produce or not to work. I'm not against welfare at all. We have to help the sick, the aged, and people that need help. We have to help our fellow man. But 50% of the federal budget has gone overboard. Where the problems are there and the exact specifics, I can't go into now, but it can be handled, which I think would be very good to sort of slow down that welfare system thing. So here's what happens. Half the federal budget is spent on welfare, roughly half. And they give this money to people, and they throw it back into the economy and buy toasters, automobiles, refrigerators, and now there's only two pieces of steel left. And there's this much money chasing it, or, you know, all this money chasing lesser products. Again, we have people taking money and consuming goods, but not producing something back. In economics, what you consume should be matched by what you produce. So there's an equilibrium there, and everything would be fine. Now, you say, well, what happens if, so what if there's all this money chasing these goods? Why don't we just sell it for the same price? You know, we saw it here first on the Merv Griffin Show, but it won't work that way. Let me tell you why. If we were the steel companies, everyone in this room, outside the door would be a lineup of people wanting this steel, and they'd have all that money in a simplified form here. And outside the door, the first guy in line would have one piece of paper, and he would say, look, I have one piece of paper, and that's the normal price before all this other stuff started to happen. Can I have this steel? And we would go, well, we'll be real nice to the guy. We want to keep everything from happening, from snowballing. We'll charge the normal price. We couldn't do it. The guy behind him has two pieces of paper because he worked, let's say, 2 days, and this guy only worked 1 day. Who are we going to sell it to? The guy who worked for 2 days deserves it. He'll say, look, I've worked 2 days. The guy in front of me only worked 1 day. I deserve to be able to buy that steel at a higher price. And that's why we have inflation, folks. And also, if this is happening to our products that we're selling as the steel people here, or whatever products this would represent, our costs as well are going up, simply because you cannot print wealth. You must produce wealth. And if you can understand that, you'll understand the simplicity of economics. Thank you very much.
Good. Very nice. Even I understand it better.
Oh, great.
Now, so today's show will be primarily involved in showing, in case this disaster isn't checked and it continues, we're going to show them today what they can do in the ways of protecting their monies, what they have right now. I hope, right?
Yes.
God, I wish
there
I could save
protection.
My walnuts.
Right. Make sure you don't eat one of these because they've been around a long time.
Let me take a break and we'll come back and talk some more with Ken.
Step into the Sanyo world of high fidelity. Real audio components together in a matched stereo system for sound that's really sensational. Plenty of power plus exciting features like Dolby. It's fabulous.
The music, that's life, Sanyo.
Shop at home, on the phone with the TV catalog.
How do you keep an entire meal piping hot until ready to serve? Just like restaurants do, with radiant heat from above. Now, Toastmasters home model Serv-It-Hot mounts easily under kitchen cabinets. Keeps food deliciously hot until ready to serve. Also adaptable for table or buffet use. Ideal when entertaining. And the complete Serv-It-Hot appliance is only $19.95. Order now, and we'll send you this quality Teflon-coated crepe pan free. Perfect for crepes, grilled sandwiches, and more. You'll also get a recipe book and crepe storage container. This Deluxe Crepe Maker sold nationally for $9.95, and it's all yours free just for ordering Serv-It-Hot now. Try Serv-It-Hot for 30 days, and if you're not delighted, return it for a refund. But keep our free gifts.
Thanks for shopping the TV catalog.
To order, just call toll-free 800-243-5000. Charge it to your bank card and save COD fees. That's 800-243-5000.
Offer not available in retail stores, but the TV catalog operators are standing by to take your order now. Just call toll-free 800-243-5000. Order your Toastmaster Serv-It-Hot for only $19.95 and receive your $9.95 bonus gifts free. A $29.90 value for just $19.95. Use your Serv-It-Hot for 30 days, and if you're not completely satisfied, return the Serv-It-Hot, but keep the free gifts. This is a limited TV offer. Call 800-243-5000. Oil company profits outpace gas price hikes. Details on News Scene with Kathy McFarland. Tonight at 9:55, just before Sanford and Son.
I know.
I'm just asking, Ken, who owns the Federal Reserve?
Well, the Federal Reserve
is not federal.
Is not, no, it is a private company. It's not the United States government or anything like that, although the president does appoint Federal Reserve Board members and the chairman. But the Federal Reserve is simply the big bank in the sky. It's owned by all the banks that belong to it.
So
it's a bit mysterious.
Have their books ever been opened for public scrutiny?
Not that I know of.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Now, tell me, what is the American Economic Council?
The American Economic Council is a group that I formed. And it's basically going to go to Washington and lobby and educate for the following three goals: a balanced budget, a gold standard, and a reduction of taxes. And we feel with these three goals, this economy can be straightened out.
All right.
If they're reached.
I didn't realize you are advocating a return to the gold standard.
Yes.
Who took us off it? Franklin Roosevelt
yes.
took us off it.
Yes, he did.
And then gold started leaving the country in great amounts.
Yes.
And Nixon slammed the door shut on it, didn't he?
Yes, he closed the gold window in 1971, where they said what that meant was gold, the dollar, if people had dollars, they were supposedly allowed to come back and take gold for the dollars.
It said on there.
Yeah. Well, this was a while before that, too.
Oh, okay.
They changed the printing of... I'm not sure the exact date, but it was quite a few years ahead of that. But when they closed the gold window, they said, if you come to our, it basically means if you come to our window with the dollars, we're not going to give you gold anymore. And they cut it off, which meant that all the foreign countries that had dollars, you know, had to keep them.
Why gold?
Well, gold has qualities that money must have. And it could be silver, and it could be seashells, and a lot of civilizations and societies have had that. But you needed something that had to be produced. You have to find gold, dig it out of the ground, melt it, stamp it. It's really the same amount of labor and perspiration that goes into producing this much gold would probably, and it's worth $50, would probably go into the same amount of energy and everything would go into producing a radio for $50. It's sort of like an equilibrium there. Plus gold, you have to have something that couldn't be counterfeited. Because if you had produced that hammer, if you counterfeited the hammer, you would have produced it. You see?
How long ago was gold $35 an ounce?
It was $35 an ounce in 1967.
So that's 12 years ago.
Yes.
It's approximately now $240 an ounce.
Yes, I don't know what the London PM fix was today,
right.
But it's
around $239, $240 an ounce.
Yes.
That is amazing. Why has it jumped? Let me ask you two questions. If the Arabs suddenly decided to ask, they don't want our dollars anymore because they figure they're not worth anything. Suppose they suddenly started to ask for gold in payment for their oil. Would we be in terrible trouble?
We could be. It just, I don't know. I think we have quite a bit of gold, and it's valued at the old price. It's not really valued at its free market price, the gold that we have. But if they wanted that, we'd probably, I'll take it back. I think we would be in trouble. It really depends. We could always buy gold to give to the Arabs.
Right.
But the price of gold would start going up, but it would go up in an equilibrium with the price of oil.
Now, Ken, we've been selling gold in huge auctions.
Yes, which is
millions of ounces. But they don't tell us who's buying it.
Well, they do. No, it is...
Who is buying it?
It's being bought by large European banks. The Dresdner Bank is a large purchaser of gold.
But America's not private?
Oh, no. A lot of Americans aren't buying that gold. It's going overseas.
How long
is... It could be bought by Americans through their overseas agents.
Mm-hmm.
But all you really know is who bid. You know that this bank bid for 300,000 ounces and this bank bid for 1 million ounces.
Why are they buying it?
Because they're smart.
Really?
They're much smarter than us. Yes. It is an absolute crime.
Why are we auctioning it?
I believe that we're auctioning it just to keep a lid on the dollar. To keep a lid on gold so the dollar doesn't look bad.
The government doesn't like us to think that gold is any good.
Right.
Do they? Why?
No. Because if gold is good, then why isn't the dollar good? See, they're trying to tell you that the dollar is as good as gold, but it's not. And if people start thinking that gold could be a form of money, the dollar would become what it's really worth, which is a lot less than it is now. The dollar is backed by confidence. Money is an idea backed by confidence. And that was by a great philosopher, Ron Hubbard, it's a brilliant statement. And I showed that statement to von Hayek, who won the Nobel Peace Prize for economics, and he went, "This is brilliant." Mm. He loved that statement, and it is. Money is an idea backed by confidence, and when that confidence goes, there's problems.
How catastrophic might this inflation, recession, depression be, whatever we're headed for?
Well, I think it's going to happen like this. I think we're going to have an inflationary economy because you've seen all that paper floating around in that demonstration.
And it's a subtle one so that we don't realize really it's happening.
Except to see prices go up the way they are. That's right. The only key we see. But that's enough, though, because, you know, people are quite worried about it. I see a probably between 3 and 9 year inflationary cycle of higher prices and everything, and then a collapse from there. But we're not going to have a depression like we had in the 30s. When people think of the 30s, they think of bread
selling
lines.
Selling apples in the streets.
Yeah, bread lines.
Suicides.
Paint jobs that didn't look good on homes, things like this, dust bowls. Today, if we had a depression, well, if you looked around this room and looked around outside, it would look still the same. You see, we have something that we didn't have in the 30s. We have productive capabilities now. In the 30s, most of this country was involved in the agriculture aspects of the economy. And they couldn't produce out of it because you'd plant seeds, you'd have to sit around and wait for 7 or 8 months. Now, we have factories. We can outproduce a depression. And if you can outproduce yourself, outproduce a depression or an inflation, you'll beat it. So I think when we have this depression, you know, this huge economic collapse or problem, we're going to be able to come out of it fairly fast as long as the government doesn't get involved again, like they did the last time.
Right. I'm going to take a break, and another financial wizard will join us after this message.
Someday, this may be the world's toughest non-stick surface, but you can't cook on a diamond. You can cook on armor coat. Watch! This is grated cheese, a sticky, gooey mess. With an ordinary pan, you'd need a hammer and chisel, but with armor coat, it lifts out quickly and cleanly. This incredible surface is so non-stick, you can clean it with a paper towel, yet it's so tough, you can abuse it with a scouring pad. We've bonded this surface to a huge multi-purpose skillet. It comes with a high dome lid to lock in natural juices. What's a pan like this worth to you? Before you price it, listen. You also get this amazing drip-proof saucepan. Liquid comes out of it like this. And oatmeal like this. How's that for nonstick? Burnt milk is a kitchen disaster. You might as well throw the pan away. But with Armor Coat, this mess just peels right off. Wait, there's more. You even get this combination omelet and saute pan. It too has the amazing Armor Coat surface. It's so tough, you can do this. We've even put our incredible surface on this unique mini griddle. Take it and discover its many convenient uses. You get all 4 Armor Coat pans, but that's not all. You get this complete 5-piece kitchen utensil set. Plus, as a special bonus, this beautiful cookbook with pages and pages of mouth-watering recipes. You get the complete set, all 11 pieces, for only $19.95. It's the greatest cookware offer ever.
Nationwide response to this offer has been tremendous. Don't miss out. Guarantee your order by sending $19.95 to Cookware, Box 3546, Chicago. Credit card users call toll-free 1-800-228-2035. If you don't agree it's the greatest cookware offer ever, return it and keep the cookbook as a gift.
Oh, yeah. Ken was just telling me, he said, from now, you've got heavyweights coming out of this show. Wait till you hear. My next guest is the host of a fast-growing television show and is the publisher of the widely read economic newsletter, The Ruff Times. That's spelled R-U-F-F. His latest book is, did you say number 5 on Time Magazine's best-selling list? How to Prosper in the Coming Bad Years. It's a basic survival guide for the average American in the troubled years ahead. Would you welcome Howard Ruff?
Come on over here, Howard.
Congratulations on that book. You're a bestseller, huh?
Yeah, it's taken off. Much better than any of us thought.
Do you have good... One thing I saw on the back of it here, Howard urged the purchase of gold when it was between $103 and $120 an ounce.
You bet I did.
Ooh, you could have doubled your money. But you don't buy gold to sell it, do you? And make a profit.
Well, I have 3 different kinds of gold in my portfolio, actually. I have some that I'll keep through thick and thin no matter what happens as my insurance. It's sort of like the automobile insurance you have to protect against the accident you fully expect never to happen, but you just keep it anyway.
What form is that? In coins?
In coins. And then I have another category. It's coins, too. It looks the same, but that's where I ride the waves. As long as the trend for gold is up, as long as interest rates and the inflation rate is rising, precious metals are rising. But if those trends should turn temporarily, that gold might get sold, or a good part of it, and go into long-term bonds, for example. You ride the waves with that discretionary gold.
Yeah. Who benefits from inflation? Anybody?
Oh, you bet. If nobody benefited from it, they wouldn't do it. Government is the biggest beneficiary. Borrowers benefit from inflation because they pay back in cheap dollars. Lenders get ripped off by inflation. Government's the biggest borrower of all.
And if I went to a bank today and borrowed $10,000 over 5 years, it would be great. Because 5 years from now, the dollar's not... I'm paying back in cheap dollars, right? It's not worth it.
Absolutely. If you could get an interest-only loan so you could have the use of the whole capital for the next 5 years, you'd even be better off. And if you use it to buy something that goes up in inflation, like a piece of small-town real estate, a small rental home or something, you get increasing value of your holding, you pay back with cheap dollars, you get tax shelter, you get income, and you win. It's like Will Rogers said, the great economist, Will Rogers, remember him?
Yeah.
He said, invest in inflation. It's the only thing that's going up.
Oh, Lord.
And if you can do it with borrowed money, you're even better off.
Who gets hurt in inflation?
Well, the people who get hurt are savers. That's bad news for a lot of people, because a saver is a lender. If he saves, he loans money to a bank, a savings and loan, an insurance company. He gets paid back in worthless dollars. Let me tell you a story that illustrated that. I was asked to speak at the board of directors meeting of a large insurance company back east. And they sat there and discussed their return on their investments. They got a 9% return on their investment portfolio, declared the stockholders, including those in the room, a big, beautiful dividend. And then they asked me to speak. And I said, gentlemen, the inflation rate was 9%. Your money lost purchasing power at the rate of 9% last year. You earned 9%. You didn't go anywhere. You just broke even. You declared yourself a dividend on profits that don't exist. Remember, the board stood up and said, oh, no, we're doing all right because we have our inflation hedge that balances it off. And I said, what is it? It's those poor so-and-sos who loaned us their money who will get paid back in their annuities and their cash value and their death benefits with dollars of far less than they loaned us. We'll take their money, invest it, get a 9% return, even though it isn't a real profit, declare ourselves as a dividend, and buy the kind of inflation hedges you're recommending because we all subscribe to your newsletter. Mm. I said to myself, if any policyholder heard that and realized that they were someone else's inflation hedge, no one would lend anybody any money long-term. The whole underpinnings of the capitalist system would be endangered.
We'll be right back after this word from your local station.
Ooh. What's wrong, Grandma? Can't you cut my paper doll?
Not that well. My arthritis really hurts.
What does arthritis feel like?
Miserable. The pain feels like a toothache.
When pain strikes you, rub on mentholatum deep heating rub. Its soothing heat temporarily relieves minor arthritis pain.
How do you feel now, Grandma?
Good enough to do this.
When pain strikes you, strike back with mentholatum deep heating rub or extra strength lotion.
Oh, the torture we women endure for beautiful hair. Messy gels and lotions, clips, pins, or those prickly rollers that are almost impossible to sleep on. But thanks to new linen curlers, there's an easy, comfortable way to set your hair. You see, handmade linen curlers are soft foam rubber inside, covered with durable, machine-washable fabric. After you shampoo, just wind your hair around the curler, squeeze it firmly around the hair, and twist the soft ends. It's that easy. And they're great for any hairstyle. The size of the curl depends on how you roll it. Set the hair tightly for lots of curls, or use larger amounts of hair around the curler for that soft, casual look. But the best thing you'll get from linen curlers is a good night's sleep. And they're guaranteed. If you're not absolutely thrilled with how beautiful your hair looks, return them to the manufacturer for a full refund. Try new linen curlers today.
For great-looking curls that last until your next shampoo, get new linen curlers today. Now available at Walgreens and Walgreens agencies, Riverty Drugs in Indiana.
Hi, I'm Kathy McFarland. For a look at the day's news, weather, and sports, join me tonight at 9:55 here on Channel 32, just before Sanford and Son. Now you have a chance to get the news before the news, tonight at 9:55 on News Scene.
News Scene with Kathy McFarland, a step ahead for nighttime news, tonight on Channel 32.
What do you say to the small... You didn't mention people either with pensions or fixed incomes, salaries, salaried people. They're hurt too, aren't they?
Yes, the pensions...
Because you don't have automatic raises that'll cover the fast... how fast inflation is rising.
Yeah, and that's where inflation is so sneaky and immoral and dishonest, because most people think they're keeping up with it, their salary increase to keep up with it, and most people don't have any real loss of purchasing power with their salary. But their stored money, the money they have set aside in their pension program, yeah, or their IRA or their KEO, is losing value without an escalator clause, without a union contract that says we'll add something to it to keep even. The rate that they earn on interest is not equal to the rate of inflation. Inflation's running about 14% now. The rate of return is 8 or 9%, and that ain't no way to get rich.
What do you suggest to the small investor, not to the big guys?
Well, the little guy has, there's a couple of very unorthodox strategies that I recommend. I can get you a 20 to 40% tax-free return on your money if you're a small investor with no risk whatsoever. Interested?
Sure.
That sound good? Okay. In inflation, most everything's going up in price, right?
Right.
Shouldn't be hard to find something to buy that's going up then, should it?
Right.
Okay. Stockpile things. Whenever you see them on sale, whether it's shoes, you want to wear a $200 pair of shoes, buy a $50 pair today. When you wear it 2 years from now, it'll be a $200 pair. Stock up. $1,000 suit, you might be just wearing it a year from now. Spark plugs, flashlight batteries, toilet paper, you
yeah,
name
but they
it.
They can't make money on that. They're not going to go around and sell it then.
Oh, no. But it's the same as if you had gone out and got an investment that doubled in value and sold it later and went out and bought it. Just avoid the middleman. Don't make the investment. Buy the stuff now, stockpile it, use it later. You beat inflation.
What's gold going to go to?
Well, I don't know where it's going to go, but I know that it's headed for higher ground. I think it may have a major correction short term, but I think as long as the inflation rate and the interest rates are heading up, it's headed for higher ground. 300, 350, none of those things would surprise me at
Silver?
All. Silver? Silver is pretty much going to follow suit.
Silver's what, about around $8 an ounce now?
Yeah, around $7.50, something like that.
Yeah.
Silver is... It's sort of a monetary metal. It's also an industrial metal. At the end of an economic expansion like this, there's a lot of industrial demand, but there's a lot of hoarding demand for it now as people get scared. Silver and gold are the world's scared money. When people are worried, when the Arab is worried, he buys a gold chain, hangs it around his neck. The Frenchman hides it under his bed. The Italian smuggles it to Switzerland. It's the world's scared money. And so good news is bad news for gold in the world.
Real estate.
Small town real estate. Big city real estate is going to turn down. I think the boom is over in big city real estate.
Really?
For a lot of reasons. Yeah, that group of two income families that suddenly by law were able to buy bigger mortgages because they had to take into account the wife's mortgage 2 or 3 years ago, they've gone through the real estate market like a pig through a python. It's just about digested. Small town real estate will boom, I believe.
How big is the collapse going to be? What are you predicting? If there is a collapse.
I agree with Ken in that there's not going to be a deflationary depression like the 30s. We're going to have an inflationary blow-off. It's going to cause great distortions in the economy. I think our distribution systems could be disrupted for a period of time. A lot of paper fortunes built on lending will be destroyed. A lot of paper fortunes built on borrowing will prosper. Inflation transfers wealth to some, from some groups to the other, but I think we're going to have some periods of real hardship for all those people who have bet their future on storing their money at interest somewhere, and they're going to be badly hurt. For them, it will be very bad indeed. Mm.
And the scenario following this disaster?
Well, that's when the crystal ball gets kind of fuzzy. Who knows? Government will try price controls someplace along the way.
Will
real
that work?
Serious price controls. No, it'll merely create more inflationary pressures because it creates shortages, and shortages create inflationary pressures. We'll have black markets, which I prefer to call alternate zones of supply.
How's Mr. Carter doing? Is he surrounded by people who know the economy and who know what to do? Is he well advised?
Well, I know he knows what's necessary, but what's necessary is not politically impossible. Not politically possible. And
it won't get him any votes if he...
No, it's not just that. It's that if they did what's necessary to stop inflation, there's no soft landing from this level of inflation. We would have to be willing to endure a great deal of economic pain. So what the Carter administration does is jawbone prices and wages, which are a symptom, as Ken illustrated, rather than a cause. It's sort of like doctors passing a local ordinance to fight flu by saying that thermometers can't go above 98.6 while quietly encouraging the spread of virus. That's right. Basically how government's fighting inflation.
Will this be an end to America as we know America?
No, I don't think so. For two reasons. One, we've survived a civil war, three total collapses of our currency, nine major depressions we've gotten through. I think our system will stand it. And second, the world's smartest money, the Arabs, the Germans, the Swiss, the Japanese, are buying American. They are coming into this country and buying land, basic things, the same kind of things I'm recommending. They believe that if this nation gets a cold, the rest of the world will get pneumonia. This is going to be the best place in the world, the first to recover, the most likely to have its institutions withstand the problems.
Ooh. Good. Let me take a break, and we'll show you the kind of things that you can buy in these inflationary times. They will be wheeled in here by a lot of Pinkerton guards, I'll tell you. We'll be back after this message. The gentleman about to join us heads the Deak-Perera Group, which is the oldest and largest foreign exchange company in the Western Hemisphere. Through his international network of more than 55 offices and banks, his company offers a full line of services in every aspect of foreign exchange, international banking and investments, and gold and silver marketing. He's a fascinating man, and I might add he's going to be showing us over $1 million worth of gold and silver in a special display here today. Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome Nicholas Deak. Nicholas? You know. Mr. Deak, I'm going to put you right in here. What does Deak-Perera do exactly? Come in, Ken. You can sit and move in there.
Okay. Well, we are known best as dealers in foreign exchange.
Right.
And in precious metals.
Mm-hmm.
We play around with some banks, too. We have a few of them.
Why do... Oh, you own banks?
Yes.
Here in America?
Well, we have two in America, and we have two in Europe, one in Switzerland and one in Austria.
Uh-huh. Why don't banks in America deal in gold?
Well, of the 14,700 banks, I believe there may be a half a dozen. They do deal in gold, but that is all.
Well, obviously, they don't believe in it the way you fellas do.
Some of them do, but let's face it, for two generations, the ownership of gold was prohibited. We lack the skill. Most bankers lack the skill.
Right.
They don't know how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't know how to do something, they shy away from it.
Mm-hmm. What foreign currencies are valuable, Mr. D?
Well, the most valuable, of course, is the Swiss franc.
Why?
Because at
least. Is it backed by gold?
Well, it's backed by gold and backed by foreign exchange. And backed in multiple of what the circulation of the money is.
Mm-hmm.
It's a small country which manages her affairs in good order.
But everybody who's hiding money in the world hides it in that country, don't they?
Well, they hide them in Switzerland, but not in Swiss francs, because the Swiss will not tolerate large Swiss franc deposits in Switzerland by foreigners.
I see.
So what do? They make Swiss franc deposits in Austrian banks, because in Austria there are no restrictions on Swiss franc deposits.
I see.
In Switzerland, they like to get American dollar deposits or German mark deposits, but when it comes to Swiss franc deposits, they hit the depositor with a so-called negative interest rate.
Now, Americans can buy foreign currencies.
No restrictions.
No restrictions?
No restrictions.
Do they know about it?
I would say that the majority probably
do
would not.
Not. No.
No.
Give us an example of what we could do if we want to protect ourselves in these times of inflation, as far as foreign currency is concerned. But what kind of a portfolio do you suggest, Mr.
Well,
D?
Okay, if you have a certain amount which you don't need for daily living,
right,
or don't need in the immediate future, then maybe it would be wise to put part of the money in gold and silver. And
gold and silver what? Coins?
Well, again, depends on the amount. If the amount is small, I would put them in gold coins.
Right.
If the amount is substantial, I would put them in gold bars or gold contracts, or just buy a gold deposit certificate.
And just salt it away. Keep it.
Right. And don't worry about the fluctuations, because in the long run, the gold price will go up. With fluctuations, might be down tomorrow, might be up the day after, but the trend is up. And the same goes for silver. And in my opinion, silver has a greater potential in increasing value than gold.
In what form, silver?
You can buy silver bars, silver contracts, silver deposit certificates, and you can also buy bags of silver coins, the American silver coins.
Right. With silver now, this coins. Is a very dumb question, Mr. D.
You might get a dumb answer.
Okay. I hope not. If you buy gold with the crime rate that we know, or if you buy bags of silver coins and you really have to buy bags in them, where do you put them? Where do you keep those?
Well, bags of silver coins you can keep in your basement. It is awful heavy to carry it away. You have to come with a truck. Or you can just get a warehouse receipt from an approved warehouse.
From an approved warehouse?
Yes. And you leave it there.
Gold. What should you?
Well, with gold, you buy a gold deposit certificate, and the gold can be stored in a prime Swiss bank, or it can be stored in Canada, or it can be stored in the United States with one of the approved depositories.
What about safe deposit boxes in banks?
You can have a safe deposit deposit box in an American bank, and whenever you want to look at your gold, you just go there and open the box and look at it.
Okay. Say the year was 1932, Roosevelt was back in power, and he shut down the banks. Would you be able to get into your safe deposit box?
No. The safe deposit boxes were also shut down. And that is why some people prefer to have a safe deposit box or a deposit outside the United States.
Now, see, what I had heard was, because I don't remember 1932, that the banks were closed. Who moaned? The banks were closed, but you could still go into the bank and make a deposit. You just could not withdraw. Is that true?
Not to my knowledge. I wasn't here in 1933.
I can't get anybody to give me the right answer. Do you know it, Howard?
I think I know the answer. When the bank shut down, the doors were closed, period. You couldn't get in for
locked.
A little while. But when they opened the door later,
right.
You could go in and withdraw your contents, your safe deposit box. You didn't lose the contents of your safe deposit box. You lost your deposits in the bank. Because
right.
that, once it's in the bank, it's considered it's the banks, really, technically, under the law, unless you come and get it away from them. But, so you lost that. But and there are very few instances of the money in safe deposit boxes actually being lost, but there could have been a while where you couldn't get at it during that very difficult time of real financial chaos.
How long have private citizens in America been allowed to own gold?
Let's see, 1974.
So it's only 5 years that the public has been allowed to own gold.
December 31st, 1974.
1974.
Okay. The public was permitted to own gold.
Right. Yeah. Now, might the government...
Gold bars. You could have gold coins before that if they had numismatic value.
Might the government ever again say, you must turn in all your gold?
Well, we never can predict what the government will say.
Right.
And that is why some people feel uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody thought in 1933 that the government will forbid ownership of gold. Nobody thought of that.
Right.
And they did. So some people think that it might happen again.
What do you expect now of gold? The Europeans, the private citizens of Europe, are holding gold, aren't they, obviously?
Yes.
No
self-respecting Frenchman would want to be caught without a few gold coins under his pillow. They went through several inflations. The paper money lost its value, and they remained with the gold.
Have you personally been through inflations?
I have been through inflation in Hungary, in Austria, in Germany.
What's it like?
It's terrible. I have seen people, wealthy people, going to the countryside, trying to buy for their children milk and butter and eggs by giving away their winter clothing or jewelry. Because money has no value, and money was not accepted as a trading unit.
What do you predict, Mr. Deak? What's coming for America right now?
I cannot believe that these things would happen in America. America is the biggest, greatest country in the world and enjoys a tremendous respect in the world. The foreign countries, people in foreign countries look to America for leadership, and they recognize the strength, the inherent strength, which is in America. And I hope and pray that America will find ways and means to get out of that monetary muddle in which we find ourselves. As it is now, we are in bad shape. but I have faith in the people of America that they will force the members of Congress to do the right thing, to eliminate the deficit in the budget. And once the deficit in the budget is eliminated, we can cope with the other contributory factors which create inflation. But as long as we have deficit in the budget, we cannot cope with the other things.
Right. I'm going to take a commercial break. And you have brought over here over $1 million worth of gold, bullion, coins, silver, foreign currencies, everything to show our audience here. And we'll do that right after this commercial break. Let me ask you a question of all of you before we go to this display right now. Because there is one danger, in a sense, in what we are saying. Suppose the influence of this show was such that people went and drew their money out of savings banks and ran to buy gold. We would then have done a terrible disservice to America in as much as banks could possibly collapse. Boy, they got quiet on that question, didn't they? Do I know how to end a party?
I'll respond to that.
All right.
On my own show, I made a comment about about how I thought certificates of deposit were a poor deal, just from the standpoint of the interest isn't enough to keep up with inflation. I got a letter from the Federal Home Loan Bank Board wanting a transcript of the show and an analysis of it to see so they could determine the propriety of my statements and whether I had violated applicable federal law.
Mm-hmm.
There are bank secrecy laws. There are laws which the government does not like people to say this kind of thing. And the reason for it is they perceive that as a threat. The problem is, if the banking system is basically sound, then nothing we say here can hurt it. If the banking system is basically weak, and if that happened, all I think we would have done is moved up the timetable a little bit. But my perception is this. As I travel around the country and I do a lot of two-way radio talk shows, which is kind of the town meeting of America,
right,
we get a lot of feeling of how people think. If there's, I don't know how many people watch your show, Merv, but I'd be willing to bet that 15% of them will believe what's said here and 2% of them might act on it. In the real world, which is the only world I care about, it just isn't going to happen. If everybody heard it and everybody believed it, it would be hard.
But none of you are advising that you would take all of your money and buy gold.
Well, I'm just saying keep it short term.
That would be foolish.
You know, if you take a look at it now, like many of our clients, I'm sure, have maybe 10 or 15% of their investments in gold and a lot of it in dollars. In certain denominations, treasury bills, CDs, certificates of deposit, and a little bit of stocks and a little bit of real estate. So you have to have all that balance. If everyone ran out and bought gold now, it would just go up real fast and then come on back down again. It'd be almost worse than the dollar. I mean, you'd really, in other words, you have to have just a portion of your assets in gold at this point. If all this money creation keeps going, then you'll see the price of gold go up naturally anyway, and people will be getting out of dollars into other assets.
Well, Mr. Deak has, yes, sir.
I have to say something here. If people take money out of the bank to buy gold, they buy the gold from somebody who owns the gold. Hence, that somebody will get that money and that somebody will put the money back in the bank.
Oh. Okay.
Well said.
Mr. Deak heads Deak-Perera. And they have sent over in a fabulous display here so we can see exactly what you can do if you feel like buying gold, silver, or foreign currencies. Come on.
With the gentleman.
Bring that out here. And I would advise none of you to move because the joint's loaded with plainclothesmen, too. Okay. My. First of all, it is so pretty to look at, isn't it, Mr. Deak?
Yes, you cannot eat it, though.
No. But it does look like those things when you were a little kid and they put chocolate inside of these and you bit them, right? See, the guards looked away. Okay. Tell us what we have here.
Well, we have here gold, some silver, some foreign currencies, and we have some gold coins.
Right.
And also little gold bars.
Okay.
The value of this is well in excess of $1 million.
All right. This is the Cougar Rand.
This is
from South Africa. That's mostly all of the coins here. And there is a premium on it. In other words, if gold were $2.40 an ounce, this would sell for... $240 an ounce. This would sell for more than that because there's a premium on the coin, wouldn't
it? Yes, you would have to add about 5% to it because you have to pay for the minting.
you have to pay for the transportation from South Africa to the United States.
Right.
And you have to pay also for the cost of money.
Right. Now, the other popular coin would be the Austrian corona.
The Austrian 100 kronen, corona, and the Mexican 50 peso.
Well, the Mexican 50 peso is the most valuable. That's an ounce point two, is it not?
Right.
Right. Yeah, so at $240, the peso would be worth about $300, they say.
Well, $290, $280.
Right.
Whatever it is.
Now, these are the gold bars. These are worth, each one of these bars, folks, would be worth, at the price right now, approximately $25,000.
That is correct.
Right, okay. And so, moving along. That's the band back there. They don't care. And this is a smaller one. Is this half the size of this? This is the $25,000 one. Gold is so heavy, you cannot believe. You want to feel this, young man? Get your guns out. I want you to feel what a gold bar feels like. Look, is
it's
that amazing?
It's got to weigh 10 pounds at least.
Easily. But
pass it back.
No. Pass it back. The weight of this is?
100 ounce.
100 ounces, all right. Mm-hmm. Are these then 50 ounces?
No, that would be 1 kilo, which is, I believe, 36
ounces. 36 ounces, so 36 times 240.
That would be about $8,000.
All right, fine. Now we come down to
that is very cheap.
Little things down here. That is 1 ounce.
That is 1 ounce of gold bar.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yep.
So that would be worth exactly
$250.
$250, right. Mm-hmm. And as we said, these are all Cougarans. Each one of these would be worth
about $250.
$250. Now, this is the silver.
There's a 100-ounce silver bar.
Mm-hmm. So that would be approximately $800 worth?
Well, the price now is between $700 and $800, so that would be about $800.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Sure. And what will be in this big bag?
These are American silver coins.
Before
the year 64.
1964, okay. Mm-hmm. Here we have the French franc.
Right.
Is there any reason to buy that?
Right now it is. France is doing quite well. And we expect an appreciation of the French franc.
Okay, and this is?
Well, this is Israeli pound.
That's the Israeli pound?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
Do you know the approximate prices of these, sir?
Yes, it is 19 Israeli pound to one American dollar.
Okay, and 100 francs?
That is about $18.
Right. Now we have 10,000 something here. What is this?
That is Japanese yen.
Japanese yen. Mm-hmm. What would that 10,000 be worth in American money?
Well, you have to divide it by 200.
Oh, Lord.
That would be $50.
$50, okay. Anything else we should... Oh, here they are.
Here's the famous
Swiss franc.
Even the quality of the money is superb.
It is pretty, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yep, you're pushing that. Now,
and we have, that is interesting here. We have Swiss franc traveler checks. Now, these are Swiss franc traveler checks, and lots of people buy these.
Yeah, they don't look too thrilled when you hand, last time I was there, if you hand one over of ours to them, and they say, by the time we cash this in America, the dollar will change again, right?
Well, that is a problem with fluctuating rates. That is why most Americans now travel to foreign countries with the currency of the country they go to.
Right. Just so that you see who gave this wonderful display to us today, there is their signature, the Deak-Perera Company. And we've been talking to Mr. Deak. Gentlemen, you know where my dressing room is. Wheel it in. Come in, Mr. Deak. We'll be right back. If your question is, are a lot of people buying gold and silver and foreign currency? Mr. Deak just said to me, what we saw here today, which is over $1 million worth, is less than an hour's turnover in his offices. True?
True.
There is perhaps no one better qualified to give us a clear perception of international monetary and market affairs than my next guest today. Here's where the arguments could start. His name is James Sinclair. He is head of the Wall Street firm which bears his name, and he's one of our most frequently quoted investment advisors. He is a specialist in international economics, precious metals, and currencies, and is considered by many knowledgeable advisors to be the most qualified man in America to be next in line for the position of Secretary of the Treasury. Would you welcome him back to our show? It's his second appearance with us. Here's the man they know on Wall Street as the voice of reason. Here's investment broker James Sinclair. Jim? Have you been listening to us back there?
I have. I like your taste in suits, Merv.
Thank you, Jim. That's all you have to say about all the hard work we've been doing out here?
I'm sorry that you took the display away before I got out.
You don't think that the country is in such terrible trouble as my guests have been presenting today, do you?
No, what I think you're watching, Merv, is a transition which is happening not only in the United States, but all over the world. And the market...
This is not just an American problem.
It's not, no. And it really is, whether it's natural or not, it's a move from a somewhat capitalistic system towards a social state. And what you're watching, as I see it, is money or capital in flight creating prices, prices of metals, prices of commodities, and from time to time, prices in equities. So it's rather a natural transition, which doesn't matter whether I like it or not, but as an objective observer, this is what I see taking place. So what basically happened in Great Britain may in fact be in process of happening in the United States.
Mm.
And it's not as...
They're a small island with not a lot of natural resources that had to depend upon their colonies to support them. Great Britain. I mean, we don't have that kind of a problem here. We are a huge nation with a lot of natural resources.
Merv, strategic metals, energy. I don't think you can say now that the United States has all the natural resources required at hand.
Mm.
I think we do have basic problems, especially in the area of strategic metals. Metals which are required for the industrial process. Metals like metallurgical chromium, which is required to make stainless steel.
Who's got it?
Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And especially...
Aren't we finding that Africa, the continent of Africa, has everything that the world needs?
It does, yes.
How are we doing politically with them?
Not well at all. So we're lacking the supply and predictable price.
Jim, talk about the map of the world, if you should color vary
yes.
areas.
It's a very interesting exercise. If you'll understand how important to our industrialized societies strategic metals are.
What are strategic metals?
Metals which are required for the basic industrialized process and for waging war. It may
right.
be a great thing if the countries couldn't, but unfortunately some would be able to.
Right.
If you took any colors, not say we took green to indicate leaning towards the right of private property, some degree of neo-capitalism, if we took purple, which would indicate a social state leaning towards the centralized ownership of property, and if we took red, leaning towards a communist ideology. And we took this map, Merv, and we took the world as a source of minerals and colored each country or source of minerals according to the political ideology which was primarily in control there. You'd find out that in excess of 80% of the world supply of minerals was under the control of at least the purple or the red, that is the centralized ownership or the communist
not
ideology.
Us.
Not us.
80%.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So we have to make our way on tiptoe in the world.
We have to have better economic understanding at the level of state.
Would you like to be Secretary of Treasury?
It would be the greatest compliment for anyone in my industry. It right. has already been.
Could you make institute great change?
No, you couldn't.
No, you couldn't.
Because you could begin a move towards those changes, Merv, but you'd be part of a great machine. If you were Secretary of the Treasury, your job would be to raise money for the United States, and you'd do your best to do it. However, as a part of those people who were opinion leaders, you could begin to change opinion. You see, no one, Merv, wants to throw the switch. I think it was a very good point that was brought up. The changes, some of which were suggested...
Well, I mean, it'll get people out of office if they throw the switch.
More than that, you don't want the cure to be worse than the disease. If you were to reinstate gold in a currency at the present time without first curing the problems that exist, it would be so restrictive as to create the forces of recession and depression as to create a circumstance as bad or worse than inflation. Mr. Deak brought out quite clearly the need first to attack the problems at hand, which are primarily overspending, not making ends meet, and then secondarily to set up a monetary system which would eliminate these fluctuations. The price of gold, for instance, Merv, there's nothing intrinsically valuable about gold, and we might not agree on the panel on that, but the value of gold is that it's a mirror. It reflects other events. It becomes, let's call it, the anxiety thermometer of the world. That's the value of gold.
But since the days of the Bible, it's been the only valuable mineral the world has ever known.
Because of scarcity, because people needed a standard.
But isn't scarcity what creates value?
It does create value, but once you have eliminated the fluctuations in the currencies due to the economic imbalances, then the standard would find a singular price.
But Jim, wouldn't it be better if all the currencies in the world were back on the gold, backed by gold?
Merv, no. It would be better if all the currencies in the world were stable due to good economic policies and there was no need for gold. Lacking good economic policies, there's a real need for gold.
Good. Here, here. Let me take a break, and a gold bug will join us and drive you crazy. We'll be back. With us now is the man who first sounded the alarm on Wall Street about the gold crisis and the devaluation of the dollar. This was back in 1961, however, and people thought he was crazy at the time. His dire predictions got him fired from a very prestigious brokerage firm, but he continued his crusade in what has become the most famous financial newsletter in the nation, the Dines letter. That's D-I-N-E-S. Most of those early predictions have come true, and he's going to give us all an idea of what we can expect in the future money market. Would you welcome Jim Dines?
Jim?
What were those predictions that first got you fired, Jim?
Well, there were four of them originally. First of all, I realized that they were printing more paper each year. They were printing paper faster than true new wealth was being created.
The government was printing
the
money.
The government, correct. So I felt that the price of gold had to go up. So my first prediction was that gold would rise, number one, and that it would go up to between the $250 to $400 level. And that was considered unpatriotic. Mm-hmm. And then I also, the second prediction was that silver, which was then 92 cents
an ounce.
92 and a half cents an ounce, excuse me, which was then at that time government suppressed, I said that would go up to between $10 and $20 an ounce.
Ooh.
That has not yet happened, but the first prediction has. Gold just made that, just fulfilled that prediction last month. And third, I said that the Swiss franc, which was then at 22 cents, I said people should buy Swiss francs, they should switch out of US dollars into Swiss francs. And fourth, I stumbled on the idea that gold moves roughly opposite to the stock market.
Right.
And I call that the Dines rule of gold contra cyclicality. And it's a mouthful.
You call it that, we don't.
It's a mouthful. Basically, simplified, it just means that when gold goes up, the market goes down, and roughly it moves in that relationship. In fact, in the last 10 years, the Dow Jones average, which is a measure of the stock market, has moved down while gold has moved up. So the theory has held up quite well over the last 20 years since I first began working with it.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the predictions I've made. Two have worked out, and two I expect to work out within the next few years.
You do.
I also said that we're going to have a terrible inflation, and that was because we were removing the various links between gold and paper money. And obviously, you cannot have a currency, a dollar which is good as gold, when you're getting rid of gold. To get a dollar that's as good as gold, you have to back it by gold the way it was when it became as good as gold. So I felt that we were going to have an accelerating inflation that would not get into a hyperinflation, but that would eventually roll over into what I called an infreshion. An infreshion is an inflationary depression. We're in that now. We've been in it for 10 years. And that is where there's so much more new money being printed that people think they're getting more money, but if you really subtract prices from it, they're really getting less income in terms of real buying power. So people get a sense of well-being and the sense of more money in their paycheck, but they really aren't keeping up with prices somehow, and this is the beginning of what I think will be a deflation in the 1980s.
How do you stop the government? How does one stop the government from just printing money every time they feel like it?
The function of gold is to limit the amount of paper which is printed. And the government knows this, and that is why it is against gold. It has tried to phase gold out of the monetary process because they want to print 10% more each year. And a really good question is, why do they want to print 10% more each year? Well, you have pusillanimous politicians who don't want to raise taxes, and they run deficits to buy votes. And this is immoral, and it's been perpetrated by politicians who are not worthy to bear the leadership of this country.
So the utopia would be our American dollar once again backed by gold.
The utopia is, first of all, that you've got to have an honest currency. because when you have an honest currency 100% backed by gold, you cannot have inflation. The reason I recommended the Swiss franc at 22 cents was because I knew that the Swiss franc was backed 140% by gold. And it was the only currency in the world so backed. And I knew that gold was going to go up. And therefore, I knew the Swiss franc had to go up. Now look, Switzerland has virtually no unemployment, very low interest rates, almost no inflation. And yet, American arrogance refuses to learn from anybody else. Look, we should ask, how come Switzerland has all these things we're trying so hard to get?
But I mean, they're hardly in the businesses and in life the way we are.
That's true. However, we should study more with a more...
I mean, don't get me wrong, they're very nice people, but they make a lot of chocolate cuckoo clocks.
The truth is...
And they have banks.
Your point is well taken. Switzerland is different from the U.S. On the other hand, I think we should have enough humility to study the Swiss. And here's a country without inflation, without unemployment, with low interest rates, and we should ask, how do they do that? I mean, what can we learn from them? Hmm. And I think that we would come to the answer is they have an honest currency. Look, the only thing that works is the truth. All there is in the world is truth and resistance to it.
Right. Do you want to give me any argument back on this, Jim?
Because Switzerland, it can't be compared to the United States
right.
in size. They have no unemployment because they simply export their unemployed. The Swiss are primarily a banking industry and love the franc moving up as it is. It may hurt the watch business, but now they sell watches at the price of Cadillacs.
Mm.
So there's no comparison between the Swiss, but I certainly do agree with Jim has said that you need honest money. And my position is that gold is irrelevant in light of honest money, but lacking honest money, gold becomes terribly relevant.
Right.
That the price of gold or the level of gold or even interest in gold is an inverse ratio to the level of society.
Jim, you call your book The Invisible Crash.
Yes.
Does that mean what I think it means? That it is sneaking into our system?
Yes.
We don't know what's happening?
Yes. I said in 1968 that we were now passing the crest of Western civilization and that it would move towards the West. I said that we were going to...
By the West, you mean?
Asia.
Right.
I think the time for Europe is going to go through a period of hardship, a time of troubles. The invisible crash we are now in is invisible because they are printing so much paper money, people don't realize their incomes are dropping in real terms. And we are in an invisible crash.
What are your predictions now? You gave us some good ones in 1961, 68.
All right.
What's in 79?
Well, I personally think that paper currencies are very risky. Look, for example, at the Japanese yen, which has gone up a great deal. Now, how can the Japanese yen go up while the U.S. dollar is collapsing when the yen is backed almost entirely by U.S. dollars? You see, this is a preposterous
Mr.
situation.
Mr. Deak, you better jump in. You just recommended the yen.
Yes.
If the dollar
the yen
really
is
collapsed.
Backed by the U.S. dollar and the yen is backed by the productive capacity of Japan, the dollar goes down, the reserve of Japan goes down, but the total... reserve of Japan is increasing
mm-hmm.
because their balance of trade is positive and their balance of payments is positive. So they accumulate more dollar, more reserve. And despite the weakening of the dollar, their reserves are going up. But I'd like to come back to Switzerland for a moment.
Yes, sir.
The sound currency. Mm-hmm. And these gentlemen are perfectly right, whatever they said, but I'd like to add something.
Right.
It is also the mentality of the people. In Switzerland, when it was a plebiscite about reducing the 44-hour work week to 40 hours last year, they refused it. The people refused it. When they wanted to reduce the retirement age from 65 to 62, they refused it. They have chosen to work. And that gives strength to a currency.
Very interesting. I think what I'll do is take a break and let the public go at you. We'll be back after this message.
U.S.
I did cut Jim Dines off after asking you what your predictions are.
Right.
Go ahead, give us a.
Oh, in terms of what I think are good, I personally am not keen on paper currencies, but of course everybody has their own opinion, and
right.
they should make their own evaluation. I think that it's getting a little on the late side to buy gold, except as a hedge against currency. After all, it's up some 600% from where I recommended it.
Right.
It's obviously not as good now as it was at $35.
I agree.
So I agree with Nick. I think that silver has more potential. It's still not up in my target area of $10 to $20 an ounce. I think silver's going to have a tremendous run-up. But more important than the metals, I think that the silver and gold mining shares are going to have spectacular run-ups in the next few years, and I've predicted that they're going to become the next glamour stocks. So I think that that's a very important place for people who can afford the risk to invest money, is in the selected high-quality gold and silver mining shares.
I wonder if the audience wants to ask questions of any of these. Yes, ma'am.
Well,
stand up, please.
I would like to say that I talked to someone about money matters. I've had severe financial problems in the past, and this person advised me not to save anything at all. That you know, that you should enjoy what you have. That life
you're just spending
is,
all over the place. Is that what you're doing?
Well, not if you're on a fixed income and you don't have a great deal of money to deal with. That you're better off making your purchases carefully, but spending what you have, because a lot of times your money that you save later on, it really isn't worth any more, okay. And life is precarious, and we never know when we might go. And
is this a question, madam?
Eat, drink, and be merry for tomorrow.
But tomorrow it's going to be all over.
Which, incidentally, inflation does that to people.
Does it?
Oh, yeah. For example, in the Argentinian inflation, 800% inflation, nobody saved anything. They spend it quick. It isn't going to be worth anything tomorrow.
Oh, boy.
And I have a copy of a letter, which I reprinted in my book, which was written by a Roman businessman to his business agent in Gaul in the last days of the Roman Empire, which was a horrible inflation at that time. And he said, buy me goods of every kind. Get rid of my money as fast as you can. It is losing value by the minute. But if you're smart in an inflationary spiral, you will get rid of your money as quick as you can, but you won't spend it on trip to Bermuda or fun. You'll put it into the things which have a good chance of appreciating during inflation.
What's happened to countries in history who have gone off gold, backing their currency?
Well, you know, there's more than one way to inflate. We've had inflations because of gold. There was a huge inflation, lasted almost 200 years in Europe after they brought all that gold back from the New World, the conquistadors. It was too much money. Inflation is too much money. You can even do it with
gold. But is there
gold.
A history of
sure.
cultures?
Oh,
sorry, Howard.
But the last point is the Romans used to make gold and silver coins, and they started adding a little metal alloy to it, and then they made them a little smaller and a little thinner, and then they cut a hole in the middle of it. That's how they inflated. That was their equivalent to the printing press. Everybody tries to do it. Every economy's tried to inflate like crazy.
Right.
The Roman Empire went under because at almost the exact same time they started going down when they went off the gold standard. The Byzantine Empire lasted 800 years and then collapsed because it went off the gold standard. Happened in Egypt. It's historically.
Is that
wherever
the
you look,
yeah, inflations are in
it's gold.
Another,
I don't. Yeah, well, so
it's another thing.
Gold is merely a discipline, and I'm quoting Jim Sinclair. Gold is a discipline. If we didn't need gold, it would mean that we'd have honest, productive, fantastic monetary leaders. But no country has ever had those for long, unfortunately. So gold has taken its place.
Any other questions out here? Yes.
I want to ask what you think of Governor Brown's. Amendment to the Constitution for a balanced federal budget. Mr. Sinclair,
repeat that question the young man asked.
Well, what I was asked is what I thought of Governor Brown's position on a balanced budget. And the answer is that it is most desirable and laudable. But things have to be done in a gradual form, and you can't tie the hands of your leadership in case of emergency. For instance, the need of conflict, war, aid, necessity to sometimes buy a piece. As pragmatic or as that sounds, the approach is right, but just like the approach we're having now, where we are having a deceleration of the creation of money. If we decelerate too quickly, we can find out that the cure is in fact worse than the problem. I laud what's being done, but I don't think you can require it by legislation. You should require it by the quality of the representatives you elect.
Howard Ruff wants to add something to it.
Yeah, there was a constitutional convention held in the basement of Buckingham Palace in the year 1642 when all the palace mice got together to decide a problem they had with palace cat, which was decimating their ranks. And they passed unanimously the solution to the problem, which was, let's put a bell on the cat. And then they turned over to a committee the minor question of who shall bell the cat. Let's say we have our constitutional convention. We say, okay, we're gonna balance the budget. We're gonna limit spending. Now we get down to the minor problem of whose ox gets gored. Where do we cut? Who gives up? Do we balance the budget by raising taxes? And if so, who do we tax? Do we balance it by cutting spending? Who do we cut? Every interest group in Washington will be screaming high heaven. It'd be the greatest political bloodletting in history, but I will sit by and enjoy it. I will enjoy every minute of it.
Did the passage of Proposition 13 say anything to the administration or to our representatives in Washington?
Sure.
It did.
I'll tell you what I think it said. It said, we want to continue to have the benefits that we have from government. We just don't want to pay the bill. The polls today, 62% of the people say we want to cut government spending. The same month, another poll says 73% want national health insurance. I think we're schizophrenic on it. And we are not coming to grips with the real issues. Whose ox gets gored? Who do we cut? Do we cut defense? Do we fire government contractors?
How about 10% from everybody?
I think that'd be neat.
Across the board?
I'll volunteer.
Lord, that would probably earn more. What Jim Dines is saying is instead of all these crazy taxes where you can take this off and deductions and everything, 10% from everybody.
They must be that much fat.
To buy, right?
It must be that much fat in the U.S. government.
That would end it all right then and there. What is this EMS?
And I said European monetary system.
Will a European monetary system hurt our dollar?
Not necessarily.
This is a group of countries who've got together.
The European monetary system was a very attractive idea during the period of time when our dollar was declining so sharply, when the common share of the United States Incorporated was dropping in price almost daily. It was and has monetary history. It was a fine idea with a historical background. It was something which would hopefully replace and take the dependency of the European currencies off the dollar at that time. However, because it's created by the contribution, in other words, we're all members of the European monetary system, we all contribute 20% of what we have in terms of gold, bullion, in terms of currency. We're all, in fact, measuring ourselves against ourselves. The value of gold, let's say, in a currency is that it creates a standard. You can have a monetary system when you have the standard. You had a magnificent system when the dollar was so sound due to good economic policy that you, in fact, had the dollar as a standard. This, in my opinion, will not be able to function in the desire that it's created for. First, because the dollar now, at least at this period of time, is not declining. Secondly, because it doesn't create a standard, something that stays there forever at a given price. And third, because it has been tried before and failed, because if we all, the six of us, are going to hold together as a currency, as a unit operating together, then we have to have inflation rates that are somewhat the same. Or if not inflation rates that are the same, at least let's keep them where they are now. Already in the case of Italy, they said, fine, you can move 6.25%, and we're all going to stay together at 2.25%. The amount will allow these common shares to move away from each other. Unfortunately, the ability for us to keep our inflation rates even at the same rate is questionable. Therefore, the durability of the EMS lacking dollar weakness is also quite questionable.
It's impossible, as a matter of fact.
It's a nice way of saying it.
We'll be back after this message.
Shop at home, on the phone with the TV catalog.
How do you keep an entire meal piping hot until ready to serve? Just like restaurants do, with radiant heat from above. Now, Toastmasters home model Serv-It-Hot mounts easily under kitchen cabinets. Keeps food deliciously hot until ready to serve. Also adaptable for table or buffet use. Ideal when entertaining. And the complete Serv-It-Hot appliance is only $19.95. Order now, and we'll send you this quality Teflon-coated crepe pan free. Perfect for crepes, grilled sandwiches, and more. You'll also get a recipe book and crepe storage container. This Lux Crepe Maker sold nationally for $9.95, and it's all yours free just for ordering Serv-It-Hot now. Try Serv-It-Hot for 30 days, and if you're not delighted, return it for a refund. But keep our free gifts.
Thanks for shopping the TV catalog.
To order, just call toll-free 800-243-5000. Charge it to your bank card and save COD fees. That's 800-243-5000.
Offer not available in retail stores, but the TV catalog operators are standing by to take your order now. Just call toll-free 800-243-5000. Order your Toastmaster Serv-It-Hot for only $19.95 and receive your $9.95 bonus gifts free. A $29.90 value for just $19.95. Use your Serv-It-Hot for 30 days, and if you're not completely satisfied, return the Serv-It-Hot, but keep the free gifts. This is a limited TV offer. Call 800-243-5000.
Hey, welcome to Make Me Laugh. This is the show where people can earn money and they can keep it laughing.
laughing. And here are the gentlemen who are going to create the laughs for us tonight. Our comedy guest stars, they are Mr. Bobby Custer. Bobby!
He's a tough-looking kid. I mean, I've seen kids with a cigarette behind the ear. This guy had a carton of cigarettes behind his ear.
There's the old Big Dunlap.
Move it. Come on, buddy. Have your e-coupons ready. Welcome to Disneyland.
Jeff DeHart.
I was right where the fighting was the worst, next to the enlisted men's club.
Make me laugh tonight at 10:30 on Channel 32. When pain strikes you, strike back. Get fast relief with Mentholatum Deep Heating Rub or Extra Strength Lotion.
Listen to me at 35.
Fascinating show, and I thank all of you for giving your ideas to the public, and now let them think about it, and they'll decide what they're going to do. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you all tomorrow. I hope.
Golden currency, courtesy of Deak-Perera. Promotional consideration furnished by Delta Airlines and True Value Hardware Stores. Delta Airlines now flies to London, England, and over 90 other cities in the U.S. and abroad. Delta is ready when you are. At True Value Hardware Stores, quality, selection, and service are why they're number one. Because True Value is more than just a name, it's their way of doing business.
McMahon and Lee Grant join Merv tomorrow night at 8. Stay tuned for laughs on The Honeymooners when Ralph stumbles onto a suitcase full of money with Art Carney and Jackie Gleason next. This is Field Communications in Chicago. Rip Taylor, Patty Andrews, and Pat McCormick get together for a half hour of fun on The Outrageous Gong Show. Tonight at 11, following Make Me Laugh on Channel 32 WFLD Chicago.
Well, there you are, Alice. That's how phony I think it is.
And all the kiddies too.
Everybody loves Leonetti's. Our chicken and beef buffet is one of the best party values anywhere. Fried chicken, roast beef, three salads, relish tray, rolls, utensils, and chafing unit. For scouts, graduations, communions, any party. Everybody loves our famous party buffets from only $1.65 per person. For your Leonetti's party brochure, call 832-8800. 832-8800.
Luxurious sculptured plush carpeting, elegant multi-level shag, dramatic, different, thick pile Saxony plush, all from Lincoln. Because Lincoln is not a retail store with costly overhead, we can offer for sale this deeply carved sculptured carpeting, enough for three rooms, 34 square yards, just $169, excluding padding and installation. 10 solid, 6 tweeds, less than $10 a month. See large samples in your home. Call National 2-9000 now. Suburbs call Lincoln Collect, National 2-9000.
Hi, I'm Kathy McFarland. For a look at the day's news, weather, and sports, join me tonight at 9:55 here on Channel 32, just before Sanford and Son. Now you have a chance to get the news before the news, tonight at 9:55 on News Scene.
News Scene with Kathy McFarland, a step ahead for nighttime news, tonight on Channel 32.